where they decide over that, the two levels of government consults, it that the two levels of government are independent, but interdependent, and shall perform their functions in consultation, cooperation and consultation. That's already provided for in the Constitution. Therefore, in our view, that is the way we want to the committee to propose to the House to address the issue of any potential conflict. It is not, the houses are not being developed, there are no houses being developed for one level of government to the exclusion of the other. The people live in every part of their country. There are 47 counties, and it is within those counties that the houses are being developed. Therefore, the need for cooperation consultation cannot be available and emphasized. The chairman, I will go to the next point. And if the members want to, we can maybe finish the five of them, then we can discuss. Number two is whether the bill has effectively addressed the issues raised by the court. And we did indicate that the court ruled that the housing levy was unconstitutional. One of the reasons was because it lacked the legal framework on which it was anchored. And on this issue, the Honorable Court spent quite a bit of time on the failure in establishment of the housing levy. One of the issues it raised was the lack of legal framework. There was need for legislation to be put in place. And that legislation was to be considered both the National Assembly and the Senate, given that the housing function is a devolved function. And our members emphasize this point in the chamber, there are no concerned counties. There is no harm in the bill being processed as it is being processed in the National Assembly, and then finally there be a new input from the Senate. Even if there is something, they can still bring, come back to this committee in a mediation, in a form of mediation, should they use conflicting provisions that National Assembly may not be in agreement with. They also found that the fact that the levy in itself deals strictly with the collection of revenue and the same was deducted from income fell within the mandate of the powers of the national government. The government was right to investigating the levy. So that's the reason which was given by the court. The court did accept that. But of course, the housing function, we cannot remove it from the fact that it belongs in the fourth schedule to account to the county governments. However, lack of legislation as to how the funds could be used and managed created a lacuna of law. By proposing to enact the bill, therefore, government is responding to the ruling of the court by establishing a legal framework for affordable housing and management of the funds to be collected under the proposed law. The bill further addresses the stability of the law in terms of good governance, transparency and accountability, as enshrined in the Article 10, clauses 2, paragraphs A and B. On the issue of the levy being discriminatory, Clause 4, Subsection 2 of the bill addresses the concern by imposing the payment of the levy to both salaried and non-salaried persons. The provision states that the levy shall be at the rate of 1.5% of A, the gross salary of an employee, and B, the gross income of a person received or accrued which is not subject to paragraph A of the statute about the salaried person. With regard to the issue of who is empowered to collect the levy, Clause 4, Subsection 3 of the bill remedies the situation which was observed by the High Court by providing that the levy shall be payable to the collector.
Yes.
Shall be paid to the collector. Clause 2 further defines the collector as a Kenya Revenue Authority or any other person appointed as such by the cabinet secretary for the national treasury, so that the perceived inconsistency by the in the law of the Finance Act, wherein the cabinet secretary for lands is the one that was given authority to the PRA, has now been remedied by this provision. To this end, we are of the view that the draft bill comprehensively addresses all the three issues raised by the honorable courts. But again, Mr. Chairman, as I said, these are proposals. The bill before the House is a proposal, and the structures of the Housing Act, and whether there will be potential overlap through the duplication of functions in the enactment of the bill. This one, Mr. Chairman, I know that the objective of the Housing Act is to provide for loans and grants of public monies for the construction of dwellings. In order to achieve this objective, the Act establishes the National Housing Corporation, funded through the National Housing Development Fund. On the other hand, the Act and the bill complement each other through a structured way of giving effect to Article 43, Clause 1, Paragraph B of the Constitution, defines that every person has a right to access adequate water sanitation. Complementary. Nevertheless, Mr. Chairman, Section 7, Subsection 3 of the Housing Act does not provide for the source of funds of the National Housing Development Fund to include allocations from the Affordable Housing Fund. This would require consequential amendments to the Housing Act, in our view, Mr. Chairman. So that, in our view, there is no overlap and there is no duplication. Should it be required to become necessary, Mr. Chairman, that some of the funds, otherwise as it is now, the funds under this levy cannot go to the National Development, National Housing Development Fund. So there's no overlap. Fourth question, Mr. Chairman, so that the bill aligns with the Public Finance Management Act of 2012 with respect to the establishment of the levy and the fund, which is where I was making the distinction. Mr. Chairman, we all know that under the PFM Act 2012, Section 24, Subsection 4 of that Act, it's only the Cabinet Secretary of National Treasury who may establish a national government public fund with the approval again of the National Assembly. Further, Subsection 4, Subsection 12 recognizes that a public fund may also be established through an act of Parliament by providing that this section shall apply to all other national public funds, including funds earmarked for specific purposes established by an act of Parliament. And to give an example of this, Mr. Chairman, is the Roads Fund under the Kenya Roads Act. There is one such fund. Indeed, Mr. Chairman, there is one that I know we created here called the car loans fund of Parliament. They are all created under different, those ones are created under the Parliamentary Service Act. So this is what in terms of what is provided for in Subsection 12 of Section 24 of the PFM Act. The salient principle that needs to be adhered to when establishing a public fund under the PFM Act or any other act is to ensure that mechanisms and structures are put in place to effect the prudent usage of the public funds in accordance with the Constitution. The bill, in this respect, proposes to establish the management board responsible for entirely managing the funds and allocating monies as envisaged under Clause 11. Further, the bill proposes to designate the chief executive officer appointed under Clause 12 as the accounting officer of the fund in line with Section 24, Subsection 10 of the PFM Act. To this end, we are of the opinion that the establishment of the Affordable Housing Fund is within the meaning of the Public Finance Management Act. That was a question that was raised in question 4. However, it is prudent to note provisions of Section 6, paragraph F of the PFM Act requires that where there is inconsistency in any other act of Parliament establishing a fund, the provisions of the PFM Act shall prevail. They take preference. It's important to note that. So that even in the event that any provisions within this bill may appear to contradict anything that is in the PFM Act, the provisions of the PFM Act will prevail. And I think for good measure, because I think the PFM Act within the Constitution is one of the that act which is anchored in chapter 12, chapter on public finance in the Constitution. Finally, Mr. Chairman, you sought our view on the fact that the bill is silent on the procedures for the transfer of public land on which the affordable housing projects are built. And the question you ask is, how does the state law office propose to deal with this legal gap in the bill? The state law does not intend to deal with this. Our reaction to this is just to explain the salient features of both the Constitution and the Land Act. Article 67, clause 2 of the Constitution provides that one of the mandates of the National Land Commission is to manage public land on behalf of the national and county governments. Further, Article 68, paragraph C, paragraph Roman 2 of the Constitution provides that Parliament shall enact legislation providing for the manner in which any land may be converted from one category to another. And this is important because further, Subsection 5 of that Section 9 provides that the National Land Commission may make rules that may provide for the substantial transactions requiring approval of the National Assembly, as the case may be, if it is land belonging to the national government, or the County Assembly, regulating and controlling the conversion of land from one category to another, and the factors to be applied or taken into account in determining land that is to be converted amongst others. In addition, Part 3 of the Land Act provides others. Therefore, the provisions of for the management of affordable housing units developed with public land, whether county or national land, are adequately provided for in the Land Act and need not be replicated in the affordable housing bill, Mr. Chairman. I thank you so much.
Good morning, Chair.
Good morning.
Jane Kagiri is my name, County and Kiki Legal Kipia, and I'm a member of the committee.
Thank you. Edible. Yes.
Irene. Yes, Chair, thank you. Irene Joki, Member of Parliament, Bahati Constituency, and a member of this committee.
Which committee? There are two committees. Thank you. Thank you. We hope you are following the proceedings, and of course you'll be making your submissions and contributions, I mean, or questions.
Yes.
Online. So, Karibu.
Okay.
Now, members, we have had the submission of the Attorney General and the questions which were actually pertinent on this particular bill have been answered. Also hoping that apart from the questions which were majorly asked, we also have other follow-up questions or questions which are independent from the ones which have been replied to. So we are open, and members, you can.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Honorable. Thank you for this presentation. I think it addressed some of the things which were very great. this bill. But you have brought up very interesting things also, which we are not seeing them in the bill. And for example, the importance of conflict between the national government and the county government, governments, whereby we need to have something to do with the consultation and cooperation in the bill. As the government legal advisor, why are you not involved in drafting this bill? Because I believe you are actually involved in drafting this bill. This kind of thing.
Any motion
of
order?
I
hope you are not going to.
And specifically, at what stage is the Office of the Attorney General involved in drafting of this government piece? Because, AG, the issue of the levy, House levy, was there in the Finance Bill. But the structure of implementing the levy wasn't there. Were you involved in the drafting of the bill, the Finance Bill 23, where this item of housing levy was being discussed? Secondly, how did it escape your office? Finally, what is contentious now is paragraph 8 of that Schedule 4. So how will we take into consideration this function to the county government? What is your proposal? Now that this bill escaped the office, you had no input in this bill. I assume that. Let me presume that. So what is your advice on the way forward to address the gap that has excluded county governments in this affordable housing bill?